and what we need to do for the actual day. So tell me, you know, what are your thoughts? First thing I want to know is, how are you going to run your day? So what time does it start in the morning? How are you going to plan who's going to do what through the day? What's the plan? Someone tell me.
We're starting at 10 o'clock
right.
in the morning.
So when do you get weighed?
It's a match of 2 hours before.
So at 8 o'clock in the morning?
Yeah.
Okay, right. So you come in, you get weighed. We'll talk about that because in a couple of minutes, that's going to be very important for you. So come in, you get weighed at 8 o'clock in the morning. And then when you start at 10, how are you going to run the day?
We're doing it in 2 minute bursts, rotating around the full team.
Right.
Until probably about 10 hours in, at which point two people can drop out and do their rest. And that just cycles through.
How long does the rest period for?
We're thinking between an hour and 90 minutes.
Okay.
I think.
Yeah. Okay.
And get a bit of sleep.
Yeah, interesting. I'd like a little note about how much sleep you got. But anyway, so, all right, that's fine. So, if we start at 10 o'clock in the morning, 10 hours later, it's going to be 8 o'clock in the evening.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then we're going to start saying we're going to have some breaks for people from that point onwards. And obviously, and you're going to go off in pairs, are you? You're going to take two people off at a time, and they're going to take an hour and a half or something of that day. Have you worked out in between 8 o'clock in the morning, 10 o'clock the following morning, the next 14 hours? So how does that work with your groups of people having a rest?
I don't think we've thought about that bit.
It's really worth thinking about this, right? Because obviously if you said, well, we're all going to take it in turns, the last two people would have done 23 hours, that might be a bit difficult. So you might want to just think about how you run that.
Yeah.
And so that's going to be really useful. It's also going to be really useful if you think about performance as well, so we'll come to that in a moment. So having a strategy about how you're going to run your rest periods, and who are the people who are going to, because you might say, one of the things you might do is you might say, people who rest early, you might have people who rest early, like the before midnight people who rest early, and they rest early, but then they'll go again, whereas some of the people who rest late, occurring later on, they may only get one rest.
Yeah.
You might decide between you who might get two rests and who might get one rest, so that, you can play that game if you could. So strategy about running the day is going to be important, but the other thing that's going to be important, what are the two things you need to do through the day? You're going to need to eat and drink, aren't you? What are your thoughts about what you're going to eat and drink?
Coffee.
Lucky you're not doing it.
making the coffee,
that's perfect, okay. So we've got to drink something, haven't we?
Yeah.
So we've got to drink something, that's the first thing. And if we think about what are we going to be burning in these 2 minute bursts, what's the primary fuel you're going to be burning, do you think? Yeah, sugar. Yeah, so if you're really pushing it for a 2 minute, your eyebrows out, go, then the thing you're going to be burning a lot is sugar. We'd like to think you're burning fat because we've all got lots of body fat that we can use. But if you're going to do it aggressively, then unfortunately you're going to end up burning sugar. Can you remember how many grams of sugar you store in your body? Yeah, about 400 or 500. So it's going to last, if that lasts people for about 40 minutes to an hour, and then they start to run out of sugar. So one of the problems you'll have in the day is keeping enough sugar going into yourself. So one of the things you want to think about doing is, when you're drinking some fluid, is to take some fluid with some sugar on board rather than just drinking water. So that would be very useful. How much sugar are you going to put into the fluid? What sort of fluid might you drink with some sugar in?
Lucozade?
Yeah, so people drink things like Lucozade Sport and so forth. The problem with those is that they tend to be a bit hypertonic. For some people, so they tend to be quite concentrated, they're not the same as inside your body. And as a consequence of if it's hypertonic, then it can draw fluid into your stomach and hold the fluid in your stomach and make you feel sick. So people get this cycling when they do it. So one of the things you're going to need to practice is doing some rowing and taking on some food and some fluid. In a mock session. Have you tried doing this?
Yeah.
How was the longest sort of session you've done like that?
4 hours.
Okay, great. So if you play through another one of those before as well, and what's going to happen on the weekends?
There's a few events,
so proper racing, which you know how to prepare for. And that's the thing is that the issue about that is how long does one of the head races take?
Racing for 2 minutes.
Yeah. So it's a very different game, isn't it?
Yeah.
And also you only do it once. So you can prep for it, you've done the race, and it's all finished, and then you can't do anything, you don't need to do any more. Whereas that's not quite what you're going to need to do. So you won't be able to practice this very well. But taking a more of an isotonic fluid, so Gatorade make an isotonic fluid, SIS make an isotonic fluid that you can make up. So it's just a fluid you can make up, depending on how much water you put in it, you can make it up stronger or weaker. Do come in. I'll just recap a few things just to set this. What I've said to the guys is actually they're all in really great shape. They've all lost fat and put on muscle mass, and so they've all been, thank you very much, mum, for that. They've been making sure they've had the right food available, and they've obviously been choosing to eat it, which is great. Most of the group is still slightly underweight to where they would like to be, so they're all saying, I need to get bigger and stronger. And that's fair enough, and they don't have any problems with that. For this competition, which is 3 weeks away. Yeah. So if they, I've said to them, a lot of the guys who need to do, they might need to consider overeating, eat six times a day, that might be having an extra meal before going to bed, so beans on toast or something of that nature. And that's fine for another 3 weeks until this thing comes up. But when it's done, it's finished, right? You don't need to keep getting bigger and bigger, otherwise you end up like the rest of the population. And I think that's really, really important. These guys are all in really great shape, and what you want to do is to keep them in great shape for the longer term. So that's what it is.
I'll say it's going to be very unlikely that I'm going to get up to 75 kilograms in the next 3 weeks. Yeah. But I'm going to aim, because lightweight, I'm going to try and keep it lightweight for the next 10 years, so 75 kilograms.
Yeah.
So how would you say going about getting to 75 and staying there?
And how old are you now?
17.
Yeah. So what's going to happen is over the course of the next 2 years, you are going to get naturally, through your training, you'll develop your muscle mass, you'll get bigger and stronger. So between 17 and 22, 23, your muscle mass will continue to develop year on year. If you look at, you may have watched on the weekend, they continue doing it until their early 30s, getting bigger and stronger year on year. So keep training, keep eating well, you'll continue to get bigger and stronger. Your issue will become, at some point, the goal will be, I need to get to this 75 kilos. And suddenly, I'm massively going, I can't stay at 7, keep going. Your trouble will be is going past it. But you will naturally develop, and I don't think there's any doubt that you'll make 75 kilograms. So it's not a worry to have. I think your bigger worry will be in 3 years' time being 85 kilos. Not fat, but just being strong in 85 kilos. So, yes?
When you were talking about eating more, so overeating, is that still healthy overeating?
Only healthy.
It's not the cakes and biscuits.
Oh, no, it's certainly not. Never. Cake and biscuits, as far as I'm concerned, in my world, but fundamentally, it's not. If you eat junk, they'll get bigger, but they'll just get fat, and it will stop them becoming stronger. So fundamentally, if they eat rubbish, it inhibits their training and it inhibits their normal development. And what they've all done is they've all dropped fat mass and got muscle mass. So they were all trained before this, but they've all responded to how they've changed their nutrition. That's really, really powerful.
Thank you.
So. Now we're talking about just thinking about the day and about the performance on the day, and there are two or three things to think about. The first thing is drinking on the day, and we need to drink some fluid, but we need to drink some fluid with a little bit of sugar in it, because they're going to be burning sugar, and there's 10 of you, and you're each going to be doing 2 minutes, so you're going to go around that, cycle. Every 40 minutes, and you're going to be up again for doing your next 2 minutes. So that's long enough to take something on board afterwards, let it go down, and then before you have to worry about getting back on board. So staying properly hydrated, that's going to be really important. Because you're only doing 2 minutes, how much do you sweat in 2 minutes? Not very much, do you? No. So you don't lose a lot of fluid. You can get quite hot in 2 minutes, but you don't lose a lot of fluid in 2 minutes. So, and if the room's reasonably cool as well, and you won't, if you keep Yorkshire is still the winter, so we're not going to be troubled with super hot rooms. So that'll be useful as well. So you won't be sweating hot. So you don't need to force your drink, because one of the big problems if you force your drink is that you can make yourself sick. The second thing is obviously you're going to need to eat. And what are you going to eat over the course of this 24 hours?
Thank you.
Nothing? Okay. You're a bit hungry at the end of it.
Bananas?
Yeah, when you go before you race, what do you normally like to eat before you race?
For me,
so, you know, if you're going to be sort of, you know, if you took 3 hours out, you have something to eat, yeah? And then, and what do you do within the hour before? Do you do anything at all? So this is a different strategy, isn't it? Because you can eat 3 hours out. Some of you might not want to eat 3 hours out because you might want to be hitting your weight, so that might be difficult. So you're going to have to then think about how do I then feed myself? And this is one of the things that is different from what you're used to doing, is that you're used to feeding yourself, right, allowing that food to go into your system, and then effectively going out into the competition, feeling, you know, quite empty, feeling quite hollow. Yeah, that's quite a nice feeling. The issue about this is it's much more like doing something like, you know, an Ironman or a longer endurance sport, where actually those Ironman people have to eat. You know, it's all right to go and do your two-mile swim. We can prepare to do a 2 mile swim and do that. But then after that, you sort of need to eat. So they eat on that 112-mile ride. They eat all the time through the ride. Because they can't eat very easily when they're running. They're going to do a marathon at the end of that. So they've got to fuel themselves, recover, and fuel themselves whilst actually cycling quite hard as well. And that takes quite a lot of practice. One of your big challenges is that if you eat too much, right, you will be sick. Right? If you don't eat enough, you will run out of energy. And the real big challenge is that, and you haven't got any time to practice it. Because the people who get really good at it, how do I then get good at it? Well, they keep going out, and the first time they do it, you know what happens to most of them? They eat something, and they're cycling, and then they're sick. Right? And you go, God, that didn't really work very well. And then they try it again, and then gradually their body gets used to it. So one of your big challenges is, if you think, all right, tuck into this because I'm quite hungry and so forth, and then you go and do 2 minutes, you might find that after your 2 minutes, you're throwing up again. So you need to think about what you're going to eat. I think that you need to take on, you don't need to worry too much about the protein. If there was, the most important fuel you're going to take on board is some carbohydrate for this. And your carbohydrates, I would be absolutely happy if you like bananas, if you like sort of a brown bread, you know, you could have a jam sandwich, you could have, you could have a savoury sandwich, I would be happy with that. You probably don't want to eat large amounts at any one time. What you want to do is every hour, drip feed in. So if you had half a sandwich each hour, or the equivalent, then obviously across the day, yes, 12 sandwiches. That's quite a lot of sandwiches, really. So you're not going to waste away, and you're going to have enough energy to do this. So the trick is just drip feed in a small amount. And you could even have a quarter of a sandwich. That might be enough. So for the guys who are going to get up in the morning at 7 o'clock, have a proper breakfast. So if you've had, you know, porridge followed by maybe some poached eggs or boiled eggs on a piece of wholemeal toast for breakfast, and you've had that at 7 o'clock in the morning, by the time you get to the training session, then you're weighing, you'll be fully hydrated, feeling good and so forth, and that's going to last you until something like lunchtime. So if you drip feed some fluids in with a little bit of sugar in, it's going to last you lunchtime. You might want to pick at something, you know, you might find something that you like. In this competition, this is a time that you might think about putting something sweeter in your mouth. You know, I don't really like sweets very much, but you might think about putting something that's a bit sweeter in your mouth. Interestingly, you don't necessarily have to eat it. So one of the things you can do is you can have things like jelly babies, or you could have Coca-Cola, and you can put it in your mouth and chew up the jelly babies, or put it in a Coca-Cola, hold it in your mouth, and then spit them all out. Just before you do your row, right, for your 2 minutes. What that does, if you do that like 10 minutes before you do your row, that tells your brain loads of energy in your body, and it releases the brakes that hold on to energy. And so cyclists do that a lot when they kind of come to a hill, and they go a big hill, they take on a gel, so you could use it with a gel. Lots of them do eat it. You can choose whether you want to eat. You might feel that you might try and eat them sometimes and not eat them other times. So you might have something like the jelly babies or the gel. You could consume that and you could actually eat it. Or you could spit it out. You need to keep it in your mouth for about a minute or two. And then what that does is it just sends a signal to your brain that there's lots of energy around, and then it makes accessing your energy more easy. Quite clearly, if you're cycling and you've taken the gel just before you've climbed the hill, there's not time if you've just put that in your mouth and you've got, you know, 100 metres before you go up the hill, it's clearly not time for it to go into your mouth, into your stomach, get digested, get absorbed, and actually get to your muscles. That didn't happen when you went up the hill. It just felt like it happened. So you can use your, you can use that as a little performance trick, or you could use that before each of your each time you're going to go on the ergo to run. So hydrating consistently throughout the day, not overhydrating, maybe a little bit of sugar into that, it'll help a little bit. Then taking some form of simple, some things that you like. So some different people, so everyone says to me, I'll eat whatever you tell me, what's the best to eat? The best to eat is what you can eat. Because if you eat what I like and then you're sick, that's not very useful. So what you need to do is to eat what you like, and it's not going to make you sick. So if you say, well, for me, I like white pasta and with a little bit of sauce on it, and I can eat that hot or cold, you know, that's fine. For other people, say, I really love baked beans. You know, I can eat that for tea. You know, if that's what does it for you, I like, you know, if you want a sandwich, you know, you said, well, peanut butter sandwich, that would be fantastic for me. Any of these, then in the performance environment, you could eat any of those. But what you don't want to do is eat too much at any one time, because you've got to remember you're going to do this for 24 hours. So that would drip feed some calories through to you. Has anyone worked out how many calories you're going to burn in 2 minutes?
Because of function, which all that's went back, yeah.
Right, so I want you to email me how many calories you're going to burn in 2 minutes. And then we can work out across the day roughly how many calories you need to consume.
Yeah.
Because it would be good to make sure you've got the equation roughly right. I mean, it doesn't have to be perfect, but you need to make sure you get it roughly right, because then you know that you've got enough fuel coming on board. So that would be a useful thing to do, just a sense check. Do I need 12 sandwiches really, or could I get away with 6? And if I'm going to get away with 6, that's probably a quarter of a sandwich, effectively, after each go, isn't it? So it's not very much. It's just drip feeding through. And not very much is good, because if you put a lot in your stomach, you're likely to make yourself feel more sick. So one of the things, if you've got a training session you could try and do, is to say, have a training session where you're going to train hard, have a little break, and train hard again. And just in that little break, try and eat something. See how it feels to eat in your training, because eating in training and when you're actually competing, doing exercise, is very different from eating, you know, 3 hours before or then deciding to eat afterwards. Because if you, what you can't do is say, well, I won't eat very much on that day, I'll just eat the following day. Because your performance will just gradually plummet through the night. So that's really important. And if you can find opportunities to practice that in between now and that event, that would be really useful. So if you've got some training session breaks, so we're going to do 20 minutes, have a break, 20 minutes, have a break. If you're going to do 4 of those, you know, just because that's all part of an hour and a half training session, then eat in between each one in the break, just a little something, and see how it makes you feel. Right? Because that's going to be starting to, one, get you used to how it feels. 2, you'll go, well, I don't want to eat very much because actually I didn't feel fantastically good. And then you'll say that you won't be eating a whole chicken sandwich straight away after you get off. Yeah? So practice it is what I'm really saying, because you won't need that much, but you will need something. So that's all about, so we need to hydrate properly. We need to make sure we've got enough calories dripping in on board. And then we need to think about performance. And this is actually an issue to mums and dads and so forth. There's no right or wrong about this. But there are things that definitely will improve these guys' performance in a time test of this nature. There are 2 things specifically. I think some of the guys have already mentioned one of it. It's just coffee. So caffeine is a performance-enhancing drug. For many years, it was banned on the WADA banned list of drugs. I suppose I'm not really speaking out of school here. It's not banned anymore because the primary sponsors for the Olympic Games make products that have got coffee in it. And so it got caffeine in it. So they, all their athletes would be tested positive if they tested for caffeine now. So because it's a performance enhancing drug, it's legal, and so athletes all use it. What it does is it does 2 things. One is it improves your body's ability to mobilise free fatty acids for oxidation to burn fat. So it sort of helps you burn fat if you're doing this. Actually, these guys are not really burning very much fat in this because it's such a short period of time that they'll be using carbohydrate because they'll be working quite so hard. They'll be working hard, and that's why the first part of my talk was all thinking about the carbohydrates you might consume. However, the other thing it does is it reduces the central perception, so your brain's perception of how hard you work. So that's quite important when you want to maximise your effort. So if it hurts less, you can work harder. So coffee is quite good for that. So coffee, besides waking up and does all those other things, it does those two things which are sports enhancing, and you could use it for that. What is the downside of using coffee? It can be a diuretic. You have to drink espresso shots really to be consuming less fluid than you will, more fluid than you will pee out. So it's a diuretic, and you do lose some fluid. But you don't, if you have it like as a cup of tea, you'll pee out roughly what you put in. So it's not, you're not really becoming dehydrated as a consequence of it. However, if you drank espresso shots, you could make yourself dehydrated. And that's why in France they always give you a glass of water if you have an espresso. So yes, it could be diuretic. That's unlikely. It's unlikely to be in this instance. But what's the other big effect that caffeine has on you that might be a problem? It can affect your heart rate a bit. That probably won't be a problem for you.
Tiredness.
Yeah, so, well, yeah, there's not so much tiredness. Well, what it might do is, it's the reverse of tiredness, it might not allow you to feel very tired. And so caffeine dramatically interferes with people's sleep. And one of the things you're going to sort of want to do at some point in this day is have a break. And in the break, the idea would be, you know, you've done your bit, you've got 90 minutes or whatever it happens to be, it would be great to go lie down in the quiet room, put some earplugs in, put a mask on so it's dark, and then actually to sleep for 90 minutes and to actually get some proper recovery. I think, in truth, the chances of you recovering well in that, going to sleep will be slim. I think you'll be quite excited, with a lot of adrenaline thrown, but caffeine makes that worse. So if we use caffeine as a performance enhancing drug, one of the things it's going to do is it's going to make getting some sleep more difficult. So you could run some different strategies with using your caffeine. You could think about the people who are going to go to bed early, resting, you know, those people are going to be resting before midnight. Maybe they don't use any caffeine during the day, or maybe they use it in the morning, but they don't use it in the afternoon because they want 6 hours really to allow the caffeine to go through their system so that they then can go to sleep. So if you're going to carry on until 8 o'clock in the evening, then someone's going to, you know, two people at 8 o'clock in the evening are going to want to stop and then supposedly go to sleep. Well, how many of you guys go to bed at 8 o'clock in the evening anyway? Not very many. So one of the challenges is that even if you've been working for these, you know, you've done these 10 two-minute sessions, you've done 20 minutes, you know, full out. It's not actually that much, is it, when you think about it? So you may not be that tired at 8 o'clock. So that's the people who rest early may sleep less than the people who rest later. So the early sleepers, you might want to have them actually be able to go again. The later sleepers, you might say, they're going to sleep later, but they're going to sleep better. The other thing that will disturb their sleep will be how much caffeine you've had. So if you're caffeined up to the eyeballs and it's 8 o'clock in the evening, there's no way you're going to be sleeping. You know? So you think about that, and then maybe, so if you're going to use caffeine, you might use that, and I think it's a good performance enhancing drug, but I would use that maybe in the morning. So you might have a coffee before you start, you might have coffee sort of mid-morning, and two coffees is probably going to be enough. What's a more accurate way of giving yourself the right dose of caffeine? Just use Pro Plus, isn't it? So you could just use sugar and water in your drinks, and you could have Pro Plus, and then you say, well, how many milligrams do I need to? So how many milligrams is another cup of coffee? Does anyone know? 15. It's about 80 a cup of coffee, roughly, you know, depending on which coffee you have. So, and do you know how much you need to have a stop having a caffeine impact? So you can look at milligrams per kilogram, that would be reacting. But for most people, you're sort of saying about 160 to 200 milligrams would be a reasonable. So it's like two strongest coffees. You'll have a proper impact from that. It's made better or worse depending on how much caffeine you normally drink. So again, in the run up to the event, certainly for a week or maybe for 2 weeks, if you can, you could avoid all teas and coffees. Will have a bigger impact of the caffeine you can have, and you'll have an impact at a lower dose, so that's quite useful. So if you can avoid caffeine for a few weeks before, that might be useful to do. And then you might have a coffee with your breakfast, or maybe if you're going to start at 10 o'clock, you might have a coffee at 8:30 or 9 o'clock. so that it's gone through, it's into your system before you start. You might have another one in the break in the middle of the morning, and probably after that, you might have two coffee hits at that stage, and that might be enough for the early part of the day, and that might get you through to the afternoon. Then, so the people who are going to keep going, and they're going to go to bed later, they're going to have their rest later, they could afford to have caffeine a bit later on, couldn't they? The people you really want to have the coffee is when you come out of your sleep. So when you've just had your 90-minute sleep, that would be a really good time, because then you're going to probably, at the end of the 90 minutes, just be dozing off, just be, you know, I've now just got to sleep and the bastards have woken me up type thing. So that, you know, that's what it's going to feel like. It's going to feel pretty unpleasant. So at that stage, then if you're going to get up at, say, 9:30, and then you've got to go all the way through until 10 o'clock in the morning, that people who go to sleep earliest are going to have the hardest job. So the people, so you're either going to have to say, well, the way we'll do that is we'll give them another break. That's one strategy you might use. Alternatively, so you might have shorter breaks. Probably shorter breaks is no one gets any sleep in that. Alternatively, then you say, well, okay, well, those people we really need to look after, and what we'll do is they'll have their caffeine more after they've had it. They get a bit early, but they'll have their caffeine later on. And then across the day, certainly it's perfectly reasonable to have 400 milligrams of caffeine within a 24-hour period. So you can have some early and then some later. And actually, many athletes would take more than that across within a 24-hour period. So you could, though the stuff that's written literally says it, you should limit it to no more than, for some people, even 200. But 200 is only a couple of cups of coffee, and that's just a nonsense. So there's a lot of literature which said, well, athletes shouldn't be taking more than 400, but many athletes will take 800 milligrams across a 24-hour period of time. And if that was in 50 milligram Pro Plus tablets, then you know you've got the dose right, rather than saying, oh, I just had some coffee and slurping away and we've got no idea how much you took. So for me, if it was me and I was organising it on the day, I'd be doing it with pills, because although it's a bit abnormal to take a pill to have your coffee, but actually you'll then say, well, we've given an exact dose and we're not overdosing anybody and making anyone more blood. Well, you have to take an awful lot of coffee to overdose, like grams of it. So you're unlikely to overdose on it, but people worry about young athletes taking coffee. It's perfectly legal. So I think for you guys, you need to discuss this with your mums and dads. I think for me, 800 absolute maximum, milligrams across a day, and many of you will get away with 400 or 600 milligrams across a day. So I don't think that's going to be a major trauma to you. I think you need to. If you're going to do it, you need to have a straight conversation with mum and dad. They need to say, yes, that's okay. And then you can take it in whatever form you like. My preference would be to take it from pills, because then you know how much you can get. If you're taking it from pills, don't want Coca-Cola. Yeah? Not that you want Coca-Cola when you're doing this, because that's got caffeine in it as well. You don't want to be taking caffeinated drinks, even teas.
With caffeine, which is it better to take it in larger doses, more spaced out, or just keep it like 50 milligrams?
That's a good question. So you're better off to load to begin with. So you're better off to have 200 milligrams as a minimum, as a start, when you want to have it start to have the impact, and then you can drip feed it in after that. So you could say, well, I'm feeling, and different people metabolise caffeine at different rates. So that you might find that 200 milligrams lasts you for 4 hours, and then you start to feel yourself coming off the, feeling quite so away, and you might find 100 milligrams then, it's plenty. And then you can do that a couple of times. But one of the bits you have to remember is that, obviously, if you've got yourself going and you've got your caffeine up there, you want it to come down to allow you to sleep. So one of the things you have to say, you have to accept, is that there's going to be a period of time before you're planning to sleep where it's going to feel harder, because you're actually going to allow your coffee to come down. So your performance for a couple of those blocks is going to be less good, because you want the coffee to come down. Yeah. So, and that's why I'm saying, after you've had your sleep, that's a great time to use your coffee properly, because then you can say, well, I've got to just stay awake now and I've got to keep going. So that's an appropriate way of doing it. So caffeine is one, but caffeine's got this problem with the sleep. Does anyone know of another performance enhancing supplement or food that you can eat? It's normal food, but it also comes to supplement as well.
Caffeine.
Yeah, you could get really complicated, but that's probably
never
going to do that. Blue test? No, we test. That's your carbohydrate talk about that. So the other thing is beetroot. And so the beets have got nitrates in each, and the nitrate in beets produces nitrous oxide in your blood, and that's a vasodilator. It lowers people's blood pressure, it improves muscular perfusion, it improves muscular clearance of byproducts of metabolism, it improves power output, it improves endurance performance. So the trouble with it is that you have to eat a pound of beetroot it's about 8 or so, but it's a pound of beetroot, depends on how big your beetroot is, but it's quite a bit of beetroot. And so because a pound of beetroot will do the job, you can eat beetroot. And I would be all for you eating beetroot. It's nice. People are very nice, so they like it. So beetroot works really well. But the issue is that eating all that beetroot, particularly on the day, might be quite difficult to do. So because of that, there's now a company called Beet It that makes beetroot in a concentrate, and it gives you a little vial, and you get the same as a pound of beetroot in a little shot you can take, and it's called Beet It. And that works really well. The issue about the beetroot is that it works quite well on the day. You're best to load for 3 days before doing it. So you need to have it, if you're going to do this on Saturday, you need to have it on the Wednesday, Thursday and Friday, and on Saturday as well. It's not very expensive, it's about £2 a shot or something like that. So it's available on the internet, but that is a proper performance heart and drug. Many of the rugby teams provide it as part of their pre-match prep for performance. So it's a simple thing to do. The great thing about it is it doesn't have any side effects in terms of your sleep. Other thing you could do is if you've got an event coming up, say maybe not this weekend, but maybe this weekend because it's only Monday, but this weekend or next weekend, you could always trial using it for the event to see how you feel. Or if you've got a time trial that you're going to do, try using it for something like that. So I'd always recommend, if you're going to change your performance in any way, that you should, if you can, always try it before to see how you feel. Because these things do make you feel different, and not everything will agree with everything. I have never heard of anybody having an allergic reaction to beetroot, but I would just make sure that it makes sense to try it and see how you are. You could certainly eat a pound of beetroot today 3 days before it, and then take one beet it on the day. That would be another way of doing it. And so you can do this through food. It's just it's just whether or not that's practically viable for you.
How close to the start of the event should you take that?
In the literature, they talk anything from 36 hours to an hour before. So the trick is to load for 3 days before. Yeah. I would load at the same time each day, like at 7 o'clock in the morning when you're going to have your breakfast, and then I'd load at 7 o'clock on the day. So you can also take, if you had 7 o'clock on the Saturday, you're going to finish at 10 o'clock on Sunday, you could have 7 o'clock on Sunday as well. Yeah. They could do two doses because you're actually competing for 24 hours. So, and again, if it were me, probably, whilst I like beetroots and I'd encourage you all to eat beetroots because they're very healthy for you, I think that probably practically the supplementation works very well. So those are my two supplement thoughts. Again, any supplementation that you think about taking, you must talk to mum and dad, discuss it. If any of your parents have got any concerns about it, then I'm happy to field any questions. And just so that you're aware, Josh, who sells, he's used some caffeine for some of his fitness evaluations and for some of the events, and we're just going to start using some Beet It for some of the more senior events. Now, I think at 17 or 18, I think it's a reasonable thing to do. I think you have to, for me, you have to get everything else right first before putting the icing on the cake. But these guys have baked good cakes. So, last thing, there's two people in the room who are close to the weight that they need to be, and so they fall into a different category, in that they're overweight. And so I've said to both of them, the trick about it, about being overweight, neither of them are over fat. So if they continue to train hard and underfeed themselves a little bit, so under-recover themselves, they will gradually lose a little bit of muscle mass over the course of the next 3 weeks. They're only a kilo out, so they're not a million miles away. So that would be my preferred drift the weight down through a little loss of lean mass over a period of time. When you go back to eating normally afterwards, your lean body mass will recover very promptly, so it's not detrimental in a short period of time. The other thing that one can do is if you find yourself 500 grams or so over the weight on the Friday, you think, oh my God, you know, I'm going to be overweight tomorrow morning, is that obviously our weight varies, as you probably know by getting on the scales, it varies by a kilo or 2 kilos every day. Most of that variation in weight is water weight. So what people are doing is that obviously when you go to bed at night, you're a little heaviest because you've been eating and drinking all day. Overnight you breathe and you lose water vapour through your breath. So in the morning when you wake up, you're lighter. So obviously fluid weight has an enormous impact on your body weight. And you can see you go to bed at, you know, whatever you weigh, and you might wake up a kilo or a kilo and a half lighter. So there's a very big difference, just as an overnight experience. If we normally drink 2.5 litres of fluid a day, if you drank half a litre of fluid a day, then we'll die from drinking half a litre for a day, but you will be 2 kilos lighter the next morning. So you can have quite a big, 2 kilo variation is a very simple thing to do just by modestly under-drinking on the day before. For the two guys who've got that, what I said is drift your weight down and then practice on a Saturday, ready for a Sunday morning, practice making sure you can hit the target weight so that you know how to do that and is sensible in such a fashion. I don't think drinking lots of coffee, sitting in hot baths, going to the sauna, running with plastic bags, I don't think any of these things need to be done. If you're having to lose 4 kilos, then we're in the wrong place. I think it's what we're doing is subtle refinements, at the end of the day, and I think that's all sensible and reasonable. And that should work absolutely fine. And I think that's probably all of my top tips for this level. Do we have any questions if people have any worries or concerns? What do mums and dads feel about using coffee or caffeine and
sort of
I think some people feel very strongly that it's not something they want to do, and I think that's why each individual athlete needs to decide for themselves and have the conversation with their parents. And I think that's it's a family team decision, do we or don't we do this, that sort of stuff. What I can tell you is, up to 17, Josh hasn't done any of this. And I do this for a profession. That's because we think that fundamentally what you need to do is get yourself in great shape first, and then you can worry about the finessing of that once you're in great shape. But I think that most people have got so much, if you've got 5% of your body fat to change, then that's much more important than caffeine or beetroot or anything else. So the getting the basics right first is really important. But if you light up and you are, you want to be world class, so you're knocking at that door, these are the things that fundamentally do make a difference. And that's what your competition is using. So if you want to level playing field, you need to use all the things that you're allowed to use legally, and don't do any things you're not allowed to do illegally. So those things, I think, and that's my strategy. That's how I work with the law. But I think that there are athletes who say, I don't want to do something, just don't do it. And that's absolutely fine. There's nothing wrong with that at all. And that's a perfectly reasonable choice. So I think you are, as a family unit, you have to decide if using those two things are right or wrong for you. Any other questions or thoughts?
Do you have any thoughts on the length of time the break for sleep should be? I know we talked about 90 minutes sleep cycles last time, but if the likelihood is that they're not actually going to get to sleep very quickly, worth going for the 90 minutes, or is it worth doing a little bit shorter on the basis that...
Having had no experience with doing this before, I'm speaking from a sort of a purely theoretical point of view rather than a very practical point of view, so I don't know if my advice is going to be of any value at all. But I would have thought I'd sort of see how you feel a bit. I mean, if everyone is, it's 8 o'clock in the evening, everyone's just raring to go for another few hours, then fair enough. But by the time we get to 10 o'clock at night, you are going to be feeling you know, feeling tired. And so you might even think about a different strategy, which might be rather than having two people, have three people go off, you know, and sort of push it a little bit later. And those people, the people are going to be behind, are going to be working harder through it. And that's going to be, in some ways, easier, because it's going to be more attention and more focus. But you know, there'll be lots of pros and cons about what's the right strategy to use. I think one of the challenges of being flexible in your strategy or flexible with your rotation is that it makes it quite difficult to run your caffeine strategy. Because for that, you sort of go, no, I'm going to go to bed at 10 o'clock, so I'm going to stop drinking caffeine 6 hours before that to make sure I'm clear of my coffee, so hopefully I'll be able to sleep. Whereas if you say, well, actually 10 o'clock, I don't feel like I can sleep now, your strategies are all out the window a bit. And that's why the truth of the matter is that there's a bit of luck with all this, because because most of these teams only ever do it once, they sort of come together, they do it, and because you're not doing it on a regular, haven't done this in this way on a regular basis, there's not an inherent formula that you're using. I mean, you've done this thing before, haven't you? And obviously you've worked with that sort of two people carrying off, and that seemed to work. So you're using your knowledge of the event, and I might probably go with your knowledge of the event. Did you have a strategy for how you picked the athletes that went first and the athletes that went last?
I don't know how they worked it out. The group worked it out themselves rather than
I mean, some things you think about is, what I would do is say, what time do you each go to bed? Write it down on a piece of paper, right? You know, really, what time, when do you normally feel tired? So some people, rightly or wrongly, don't like to go to bed until quite late. Some people like to go to bed a bit early. So if you're an early sleeper normally, I'd be saying, well, I'll take the early shift. And so I try and sort of play to your own natural physiology a little bit in terms of deciding who's going to go. You probably need to agree your strategy about who's going to go when before you do the event, and only crisis manage if there is a crisis. Don't be flexible in it, because otherwise, if you then do run a caffeine strategy, you'll get your caffeine all gone, and then you'll find you're in bed but you can't sleep. So that would be my own thoughts. But I don't have any experience running these teams in this way, so I can't really comment very much. Any other thoughts? Well, the best of luck. I hope it all goes really well. If anyone's got any questions in between now and then, please let me know. I'm happy to take emails or questions. And if you let me know how much you're going to burn in your 24 hours, in terms of what you think the calorie expenditure might look like, then we can just send a check against the sort of a backdrop of most of us, your weight will be burning 1,800 to 2,000 or so calories a day, and you can have a rough estimate of what's the total number of calories you want to take on board in that 24-hour period. And then, because you're going to be up for quite a lot of it, apart from this little short break, then you want to drip feed across the day to keep yourself fueled, rather than having it all in a day and nothing at night, because that might work very well in this circumstance. Have a really good time. Let me know how you get on. Come back to me.
Thank you very much.